I'll just give a few more minutes, maybe one more minute to start our summit. Right, so maybe I can start by just giving some background. It's already 3:30. We'll start by just discussing the main objectives of the summit and welcome you all. This is Radhika Iyengar at the Center for Sustainable Development, and I'm here with my colleagues, Hain and Tara Stafford Okanse. Thank you for joining our summit, and glad that all of you could make it. We'll start by just showcasing, this is a week-long summit. We have our partners as New Jersey Audubon and National Wildlife Federation. They have been working in this area for a very long time and are very, very experienced. So we'll welcome them as well. Emily and Allison have been great brainstorming partners. So thank you all for, thank you Emily and Allison to be our brainstorming partners here to organize the summit. The summit actually came about by doing a lot of our work on the Eco Ambassadors program in New Jersey, especially in Melbourne, New Jersey, as well as in other places in New York as well. So this is a program that is based at Columbia University at my Center for Sustainable Development. And we have been working at the intersection of eco-activism and science training through our Lemon Dorothy Earth Observatory scientists and doing a lot of showcasing of social outcomes as well, including a lot of eco-activism and making this whole science aspect very holistic. You can get a lot of our work here on, you can see a lot of our work on our website that's given on the right-hand corner of the slide, and definitely look at our work at the Center for Sustainable Development as well. This is a really great program that translates science into eco-activism in our communities and solves real-life environmental education problems. Also, we have some programs that we've developed through our work with the eco-activists, through the eco-ambassadors program. We've developed a free online course for teachers that focuses on sustainable development goals across curriculum and education spaces. I just want to play this video here just so that we get a glimpse of our program.
The events of 2020 have given us an opportunity to dig deep into the critical issues of our time and see global education on sustainable development as a key to revive, reform, and reshape the world. We connected with researchers, practitioners, activists, advocates, teachers, professors, parents, and students to sketch a roadmap of where we are and where we need to go. Our flagship program, Eco Ambassadors, has been published in top-tier education journals. Our conversations this past year have helped identify roadblocks to achieving global sustainability education, frame education for sustainable development's curricular design and approach, engage political and education leaders and global thought leaders, learn from community advocates and hear insights from learners in classrooms and homes. We have carefully crafted some key lessons from these conversations, conferences, workshops, and talks into an online course that can help to frame and guide education stakeholders in how to approach a holistic education for sustainable development design, to integrate climate change education, environmental education, and social emotional learning into existing curriculums for both school and community settings. This course will help outline the process that could be helpful for the integration of sustainability into education and make SDG 4.7 a reality. We hope you will join our course to learn along with us.
Great. So that was a quick outline of our
unexpected events of 2020. Have
stop this and start sharing my slide again. Great. So in this summit, we are coming again with a lot of research on the ground, a lot of eco-activism, a lot of science, and also these programs that we've developed for the teachers, the courses that we've developed for the teachers, and have combined all these activities into a summit, which runs this whole week. So I hope that everybody will be able to join each day, because each day is very different. You've seen the main headings here. There'll be a panel every day. There'll be a workshop that will be there, and it's very activity-based and it's very skill-based. So we will get to learn a lot towards the end of this week. We will actually plan a going forward or an action plan that we need to develop as a part of the Eco Ambassadors program. So I hope everybody will be able to stay till and devote some time here, have a strategic plan towards the end, and we really need to make your voices heard. It needs to be a combined effort. Here is what we needed from you all. If you're all participating, please make sure that you go on our forum, edforsd.org forum. You'll be able to locate where you can send in all these ideas. You don't have to wait till the end. Keep your ideas coming. Keep your ideas coming so that we can, towards the end or on Friday, we'll be able to compile all these responses and come up with a concrete plan going forward for the Eco Ambassadors program. Also visit our website at Columbia so that you can see all the programs that we are doing. You can start your own eco activism chapter based in New Jersey and in New York. So I definitely welcome you all to be participating with that. Day one is a very exciting day for us because we have two very important guests. We also have panelists. We also have workshops going. And we just want to frame this discussion on why climate action through education is important. And we have none other than a very inspirational leader who's joined us today, the First Lady of New Jersey, Ms. Tammy Murphy, who's really spearheading a lot on climate change education, which is integrated into New Jersey's school curriculum and is really one of its kind. I think she's spearheaded not only in New Jersey, but maybe giving hope and inspiration to many other leaders, national as well as international. So with that, I'll welcome the First Lady to inspire us with her words. Thank you, Ms. Murphy, joining us.
Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you, Radhika, for that introduction, as well as your leadership at the Earth Institute. I also want to thank Dale and the New Jersey Audubon Society for the invitation to speak today and an unwavering dedication to the climate crisis. And I obviously want to thank all of the young people who are participating in this conference from New York and, of course, the great state of New Jersey. New Jersey and New York have a special and interdependent relationship. What is more, I think the world agrees that our youth have a reputation for being the most dynamic, independent, don't take no for an answer generation. I also know that when we join forces, we can take on any issue, no matter how challenging. So I am thrilled and eager to share with you all that we have done on our side of the river with respect to climate change education. let me start with a brief overview of where we are and how we got here. Currently, New Jersey is the first state in the nation to incorporate climate change education across all K-12 education standards. That means that from kindergarten through high school graduation, our students will learn about climate change in every subject area: English, language arts, mathematics, science, social studies, technology, 21st century life and careers, visual and performing arts, comprehensive health and phys ed, and world languages. Our teachers are working here and now on the curriculum, and climate change education will start rolling out in our classrooms this September. The broad scope of incorporation across subjects comes from an understanding that the threat of climate change is more complex than one unit in science class can ever cover. We know, because the science has told us, that climate change is going to affect every part of our lives, the way we travel, eat, dress, build, recreate. I can go on. To fully confront this crisis, we need a diverse group of policymakers able to make informed decisions and take needed legislative action. Urban planners ready to help cities adapt to increased rainfall and storm surge. Insurance brokers prepared to help homeowners navigate new risks. Artists who can communicate the impending threat that climate change poses, and. Quite frankly, to appropriately prepare our students, all of you, for the world you are inheriting, we need to make sure you are climate literate. So how did we begin this undertaking? Firstly, we were incredibly lucky to have a bit of fortuitous timing. In New Jersey, our learning standards are reviewed every 5 years by the Standards Review Committee. This committee is comprised of more than 130 educators from all across the state who are selected to serve based on their experience and background. In March of 2019, the Standards Review Committee began updating New Jersey's state education standards. I first brought the idea of including climate change education to the committee at their opening meeting and continued to advocate for it at each subcommittee meeting throughout the year. I was incredibly impressed, inspired, and encouraged by the level of creativity our educators brought to shaping these standards. It's not an easy task to set a standard of education for a kindergartner on a subject as complex as climate change, or to imagine how this topic might fit into the performing arts curriculum, but they did it, and they did it flawlessly. I really cannot stress enough how much respect and admiration I hold for New Jersey's educators, many of whom graduate from some of New Jersey's renowned institutes of teacher education, as well as New York's. And I'm very eager to see this come to fruition in our classrooms in the 2021-22 school year. We also need to get the ball rolling on this issue because New Jersey is on its way to achieving 100% clean energy by the year 2050. With this in mind, we need our students to be well-equipped to take on the future green economy as leaders filling jobs in every industry. So you can see that education is really the linchpin of our strategy. We have goals set for clean energy. We have plenty of policies to get us on track, but all of this hinges on our residents understanding the threat and being part of the solution, no matter what career they pursue. The title of your conference today, Why Climate Action Through Education, is a great question with a great answer. Honestly, it reminds me of a quote from a television show that's about 15 years old called The West Wing. It's a great show that depicts a White House administration, and if you haven't seen it, you should. Anyway, in one episode, a character says, education is the silver bullet. Education is everything. We don't need little changes. We need gigantic, monumental changes. So why climate action through education? Because we believe in the power that education holds to change lives, to make the future better, healthier, and fairer. And on top of all of that, because this generation, all of you, are rising to the challenge, you are meeting a moment that human history has given you. Despite the existential threat and complex challenges we face, I am incredibly optimistic on this issue, simply because this generation of students is already motivated to act on climate change. This effort is so much more than an added educational requirement. It's really a symbol of a partnership between generations. And for our students in environmental justice communities who suffer the most deeply, the effects of air pollution, the climate crisis is even more personal. Climate change is not just an environmental issue. It's a social justice and equity issue as well. And this generation understands that. This will continue to be an important part of the conversation as all of you become the leaders and policymakers of our world. And this is our part of the bargain. We're handing you a real problem that will continue to affect every aspect of your lives. If we don't educate you and give you the tools you need to understand the dangers of climate change and how to combat it, no matter what career you pursue, then I believe we are being negligent. It's our responsibility to make sure you're prepared for the world that awaits you, and climate change education has become a part of that responsibility. As our updated education standards continue to receive national attention, I could not be more thrilled. And I hope that you will reach out to the networks you have built through social media to raise awareness of this movement. Because while I'm incredibly proud that New Jersey was first in this endeavor, I can't wait to see which state will be next. Just between us, I do hope it's New York, by the way. Thank you all so much for the opportunity to be a part of today's program. And I am looking forward to watching with amazement as all of you take the lead on this issue. We're all really counting on you. Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you so much, Ms. Murphy. It's really a pleasure to hear you and get your vision on how much importance you give to all of us and empower us so that we can be the change leaders. And it's not just the school systems. You basically said that, you know, a lot of others, a lot of youth can take this issue and bring solutions to it. So I really appreciate that thought that it is our problem and we are here to solve it together with all the leadership and all the efforts that you are taking to lead this particular aspect. Thank you so much for those really important words. I think you have really set the stage for our summit really well so that we can take charge and make use of this particular summit so that, you know, we can be the leaders in our own fields and make sure that all of us work together to resolve this particular problem. Thank you, Ms. Murphy, for your kind intervention there. I just wanted to go over our next couple of slides. We're still waiting for Professor Sachs to join, but I also want to introduce Professor Sachs in the meantime. He is a university professor at Columbia University. He's also the advisor to the UN Secretary General on Sustainable Development. He has been the advisor to the UN Secretary General on Millennium Development Goals and now the Sustainable Development Goals. So now we are going a little bit more on the global sphere and tackling this problem of climate change through multiple different lenses, including one of the main lenses that the UN has is the Sustainable Development Goals that many countries have agreed on. So Professor Sachs has been one of the inspiring leaders who have shaped this dialogue of sustainable development goals. And our role in this summit will be to learn about the sustainable development goals and make it our own and see how we can use this particular framework in our own areas and in our own neighborhoods. So we'll continue to have that discussion with Professor Sachs. He'll give us some ideas on how we can resolve this, you know, how we can tackle this challenge that is on us, climate change challenge, and use the sustainable development framework to localize it in wherever settings that we are in, and we'll be able to make sure that we are able to tackle this particular problem through the sustainable development lens. We have three more students here who are from New Jersey who will be asking Professor Sachs some questions. And they are Navya Jain. She's a sophomore at Newark Academy in New Jersey. We have Purva Bomireddy. She's a senior at Middlesex County Academy in New Jersey. And Ishan Bhardwaj, who's from seventh grade in schools in Melbourne. So Melbourne School in New Jersey again. So we welcome all our youth who are taking the leadership and making sure that we are asking the right questions and making sure that we are taking this much more broader sustainable development lens and learning from the experience that the world is facing right now in terms of climate challenges and localizing it to our own areas and neighborhoods. So thank you all for joining, Navya, Purva, Ishan. I don't know if we can see you on our screens. Great. I can see Navya, Ishan. Great. So I think we are all here just waiting for Professor Sachs to join. I'm sure he will be there in just a few minutes, joining us from, you know, probably running from his class to another class or going from one meeting to the other. So he will be joining us very soon. Meanwhile, maybe Navya, you can introduce yourself, and Purva and Ishan as well.
Sure. So my name is Navya. I am a sophomore at Nerd Academy, like Radhika already mentioned. And I am also the high school co-chair for the New Jersey Student Sustainability Coalition, which is a group of college and high school students that work to push sustainability initiatives in New Jersey. And then I can pass it on to Purva.
Yeah, sure. So hi, everyone. I'm a high school senior studying civil and mechanical engineering at the Middlesex County Academy for Science, Math, and Engineering Technologies. I really am passionate about advocating for youth action and public education around single-use plastics and environmental issues. So this summit really means a lot to me in terms of really advocating for students to step up in their communities and really create change. So I hope everyone is able to take something meaningful away from this week-long summit. And I work with Bye Bye Plastic Bags New Jersey as the team leader in advocating against single-use plastics. And I'm also the Plastics Project co-coordinator for the New Jersey Student Sustainability Coalition. And I, in the future, hope to pursue environmental engineering to kind of combat the connection of sustainability and innovation to hopefully address emerging design challenges. So with that being said, I'll pass it over to Ishan so he can introduce himself as well.
Hi, my name is Ishan Bharadwaj. I'm in seventh grade and I go to Milburn Middle School in Milburn, New Jersey. And I love being an environmentalist. I do love doing environmental projects. And I'm overall looking forward for this conversation with Professor Jeffrey Sachs, and just really excited.
Great. Thank you, Ishan. Thank you, Purva. Thank you, Navya. I think your leadership and your initiative has shown that no grade is a small grade and no grade is a big grade. I think this problem needs to be tackled by each and every one of us. So thank you for taking the leadership, Ishan, Purva, and Navya, in your own ways, so that we can tackle this idea of climate change. We all come from various different countries in the US. In my case, I also work in various different countries. And I think every country is facing this particular challenge, climate change challenge, in so many different ways. And all our lifestyles are being impacted. So I think the responsibility lies on each one of us to take this problem, tackle it, and see what we can do locally. So the Eco Ambassadors program, as I was mentioning, is a great way to engage our minds with science and with social science, so that we can tackle this problem. As the first lady I had mentioned, that it is not just a problem of just a science issue, or we can focusing on only on the science class. It has to be tackled in all the different classes and has to be taken together in a much more comprehensive way, in a much more systems oriented way. So I think this whole summit will be able to tell us the various different dimensions that we should be looking at so that we can tackle this problem of climate change using various different lenses. I think it's a great opportunity to, let me see if I can quickly share our website. So that you can get to see our program a little bit better. This is our website at Columbia. Maybe you can, so edsd.csd.columbia.edu is the website's name. And we have this whole, you know, program, the Eco Ambassadors program here. You will be able to register. You can start your own chapter here and then, you know, read, join our conversations. We have this huge pool of, you know, YouTube resources that we've compiled together. You can share and write up a document. You can partner up. So this is a really great website to focus on the sustainable development goals. At the Center for Sustainable Development, we work on basically goal four is quality education. So that's where our work is situated, but clearly a climate issue is connected to all these different 17 goals. So I would suggest to all see how, you know, all these different goals are working together and we are able to resolve our own local challenges. So definitely go on our website, edsd.csd.columbia.edu. We can also write it in the chat or write it in our Q&As to see how you can partner with us on this particular issue. I also want to share the screen that I shared earlier on. This is edforsd.org is our interactive tool where we can actually, you can write up post, you can see all our work. You have, you know, this is a page. It looks like we have an Eco Ambassador program here at the Center for Sustainable Development. As I was mentioning, we have a lot of programs that we are doing internationally as well. So you might be able to benefit from our, international education, work as well. You'll be able to see what our, programs are get a glimpse of what other countries are doing and how other countries are gearing up this, using the citizen science approach. You'll be able to understand more about your role as a climate activist, but keeping the science really as the focus here. So I think those are some very critical. And as we had mentioned earlier on, this edforsd.org, please continue to keep sending your ideas, suggestions in this forum component. You'll be able to, we will compile at the end, we will compile all these ideas on the forum to come up with an action plan, which we had mentioned in the previous slide. So here, so we have, on Friday, we will come up with all the forum discussions that you've been able to enter. We will have all those come up again, and we'll be able to have an action plan. That will come up, and we will have an Eco Ambassador program based on what the action plan is actually showing. So make sure you submit all your ideas and your discussion points in that forum. Today we will be discussing why climate action through education is important. On Tuesday, we will be pushing for climate action in and out of schools. This is a big focus, as the First Lady was suggesting, that it is not just a classroom problem. We have to tackle this all together. So we should be able to take all of these aspects and we'll be able to, take all of this action points and use it in classrooms as well as outside in our own communities, in our own homes. On Wednesday, we will be doing education for climate action, which is a teacher's perspective. So I invite all the teachers to join our panel discussion, see where we are going with this. And on Friday, again, we will be focusing on communication arts for climate education. We will be focusing on, we've invited renowned communication experts, we've invited scientists and a lot of different range of stakeholders here so that we get a sense of the entire, climate action related action rather than just focusing on the science component. And then on Friday, we are honored to have really special guests from our Navajo punk rock band. They will be here discussing music, but they are focusing on climate action. So we will definitely be learning a lot on based on their experience. So those are our five packed full days. I hope you will be able to make use of those days, and you will be able to use this time that we have together in a really productive way. So I hope all of you can stay on till Friday the 12th, and you'll be able to have that be a part of the action plan together. Great. So maybe wait for maybe five more minutes. I just got a text that Jeff will be joining soon. So maybe we can wait for like five more minutes. Meanwhile, I would suggest you to look at our website, start submitting these our forum ideas. Make sure you are submitting your ideas soon so that you can get your ideas going with at least just the initial ideas, and then we can obviously refine it with more discussions as we go along. So maybe five more minutes. I'm sure he'll be joining us very soon. Great. So I think Jeff is here. Thank you, Professor Sachs, for joining us. It's really a pleasure to have you here. We just heard from Ms. Murphy, the First Lady of New Jersey, on how integral it is to have climate change education in the curriculum. And now we want to get a global perspective from you, Professor Sachs, so that we can understand the role of sustainable development as well as the UN goals. Sustainable development goals, to see how we can all situate ourselves in that global perspective. As I mentioned earlier to our students and teachers, there are around 200 students and teachers here who are wanting to hear from you on how can we actually use the UN sustainable development goals to tackle this issue of climate change, and how can education be an integral part of it. So maybe after your short speech, we have our student moderators here, Navya, Purva, and Ishan, who will be asking you some important questions. They've worked very hard on the questions, and they're ready with all difficult questions for you, Mr. Sachs. So if you can maybe just say a few words, and then we can turn it over to the students to ask you questions.
Thank you very much. I want to turn it over to the students right away. I'm so happy that you're pursuing this. This is real leadership of the students. So thank you so much. The issues of sustainable development to be more fair in our society, more inclusive in our society, more environmentally smart in our society is obviously really important. And I think this terrible epidemic reminds us of what can happen when we're not paying attention and we're not really treating nature seriously and treating each other seriously and fairly. So COVID-19 has been a really hard hit for us, and it's a reminder that we need to be a lot smarter in how we're organized in society. The first thing is we need to understand what's happening to us. And maybe if President Trump had gotten a better education, we would be in better shape right now. But obviously, he didn't learn at school or listen very carefully. So we ended up in a real mess on many, many fronts. But now we're trying to get out of that mess. And this year is a big year for doing that. We have a new president. He's going to have a lot of plans. He's returned the United States to the Paris Climate Agreement. So we're part of the UN system again. Today, I was so happy to see that the United States is going back to the Human Rights Council, saying that we take seriously human rights. And that's a major part of the UN and a major idea, human rights for everybody. So I was very happy to see President Biden leading on that. We have a lot of opportunities. Let me not speak anymore. Navya, over to you. And I'm interested in hearing the questions. And you're on mute.
Okay, great. So we're hoping to get through one question each today. So I'll get started as quickly as possible.
Great.
Yeah.
So, what year are you in, Ishan?
I'm 12. And
you're 12?
I'm in seventh grade. And
in seventh grade, great.
I go to Melbourne Middle School.
Excellent.
So my first question is that in your book, The Ages of Globalization, Geography, Technology, and Institutions, I liked your reference of John F. Kennedy's goal of reaching the moon by the end of the 20th century, and that sustainable development must be our moonshot. But sustainability is a little broad. So what's a specific goal in sustainability that's going to be our generation moonshot for the next 10 or so years?
Fantastic. So when I was little bit younger than you, that was a long time ago, but back in 1961, you can read about it in your history books, I was seven, and President Kennedy gave a speech. He said, I believe that this country should adopt the goal before this decade is out, in other words, within the 1960s, to send a man to the moon and return him safely to the earth. And he said, no project in space will be more important, more significant, and more difficult and expensive, but we should do it, he said. And the whole country got very excited. I was seven, so I was very excited. And I watched all of the space shots from 1961 all the way to Neil Armstrong landing on the moon, walking on the moon in July 1969 and coming back safely to Earth, just like President Kennedy said, and on the same timetable. So it was really amazing. Now that was way back in the 1960s we did that. There were no cell phones, there were no personal computers. In fact, when the space shot started, they didn't even have a computer at Cape Canaveral, where the first missions to space were made. They used teletype machines. You don't even know what those are because they're so old and they don't even exist anymore. So we were able to do things that put forward new scientific ideas. NASA, which our government agency for space exploration, really developed solar power, for example, using photovoltaic cells for satellites in space. And think of all the benefits that we get from that now, because that's going to be crucial for a safe environment. We have our own moonshots now. And I think one of the absolute key, clear, specific missions that we have is to change the way we use energy from fossil fuels, coal, oil, and natural gas, to renewable energy like wind and solar power. Because when we use wind and solar power, we don't heat the climate. We don't cause climate change, which comes from carbon dioxide emitted from burning fossil fuel. So that's why we have a big need and a big opportunity to shift from fossil fuel to renewable energy. We don't have much time to do it because we lost a lot of time. And during the last 25 years, all of the world together burned a lot of fossil fuel and made the climate already too warm. 2020 was the tied for the hottest year in history. And so that's a mess. So we have to hurry now and decarbonize. And how do we do that? Well, photovoltaics, that is solar cells, wind turbines, both onshore and offshore, driving electric vehicles rather than internal combustion engine vehicles. And we need to make this a moonshot in that we set a timetable and say, we're gonna do it within this time, because if we delay it, then the warming is gonna be super dangerous for everybody, including for us in New York and New Jersey. So this is why we have to move fast. There are other goals too, but I'll keep on that one because you asked me to be specific. So let's keep on the goal of decarbonizing the US and the world energy system, certainly no later than 2050, and even sooner than that if we can. But great question. And Ishan, you're gonna be a real leader in this. So that's really important to figure out how you can really do this. And I'll tell you, the experts don't know for sure. So should we use wind? Should we use solar? How do we, how fast should electric vehicles be brought in? There's a lot to study and a lot to test. Will the cars drive themselves? This is, you know, one big idea right now that we're gonna have not only electric vehicles, but they're gonna drive us rather than us driving them. These are all areas where you could do a lot of big help to figure out the answers. Good to meet you.
Thank you so much for that answer, Professor Sachs. So my name is Navia and I'm a sophomore at Newark Academy. So I'm gonna be asking a question combining your backgrounds in both economics and sustainability. So I, in your answer to Ishan's question, I know you mentioned something about a clean energy economy. So recently the Biden administration outlined four main areas where they will focus, two of them being the economy and climate change. However, Biden recently signed an order to revoke the permit for the Keystone Pipeline, coming under fire for ending jobs and declaring a so-called war on the economy with his climate plan. In your opinion, how is the administration to prioritize one goal over the other? And how could we move to a sustainable economy that tackles both goals simultaneously?
Great question, Navia, thank you. First of all, bravo President Biden for canceling the Keystone Pipeline. What a dumb project that was. You know, we shouldn't do dumb things. If you're trying to save the planet by getting out of fossil fuels, you don't build a pipeline to make more fossil fuels. And so this was a very bad idea. And the people that were defending it, well, they were gonna make a lot of money maybe pumping a lot of the oil from Canada to the south of the United States, but the product was very dangerous because it was going to worsen the climate change. Then they said something I thought was very, I don't know if you'd say funny, but very indicative. It showed something was wrong. They said, oh, no, the pipeline is gonna be 100% renewable energy. And so they were telling environmentalists, don't worry, we're gonna use renewable energy for the pumping of the pipeline. But what they didn't say is what the pipeline is gonna carry is oil that's gonna make the climate change much, much worse. So when they said that the pipeline will be 100% renewable, that's the kind of advertising, misleading advertising that confuses people. The pipeline was going to be carrying a very dangerous product that we don't need right now. These heavy oil sands producing oil in Canada, we've got enough oil in this world, more than we can safely use. We have to shut down the oil that we're using. We have to shift away from the gas guzzling cars, as I was just saying, because it's too dangerous to burn more gasoline. So bravo to President Biden. Now, what about the jobs? Well, there were a few hundred, maybe even a couple thousand temporary jobs in the pipeline, but then the number of jobs that would be destroyed all over the world for decades to come by climate change wasn't mentioned. All the damage that this would do. So we have to take a longer term picture, and we have to understand that there are many good jobs in the green economy, building solar panels, building wind turbines, building smart grids, installing new renewable energy power generation, refitting buildings so that they're more energy efficient. So many good jobs to be created. We don't have to produce bad, harmful things for jobs. People should work on things that are contributing to the well-being of society, not things that are detrimental to the well-being of society. We don't need to make jobs to do bad things. And that's what Keystone would have done.
Thank you for the really insightful response, Professor Sachs. So my name is Purva. I'm a 12th grade student at the Middlesex County Academy for STEM.
Great.
And I'll be shifting gears a little bit to talk about more of something that reflects the theme of our summit today. So in your book, The End of Poverty, Economic Possibilities for Our Time, you've written about the importance of increasing educational access through a global fund for education. So kind of going back to our actual theme today and what we've convened for, as well as our large youth audience, what do you believe that students across the world should be educated about climate change? And what role do you envision that education will encompass in the future of actually leading towards sustainable development?
Great, Purva, thank you very much and good luck in your studies. That's for all of you. Thank you for your interest in this, because it's so important. Actually, as part of the 17 Sustainable Development Goals, one of them, SDG number 4, says that everybody in the world should get a decent quality education. And you're getting one, thank goodness, but how many children are not getting educated because there may not even be a school where they live, or the costs of going to high school are so high that their parents and the community can't afford it? We know that even before COVID, there were estimated to be 260 million school-age kids not in school. And now the number has gone up so much because of the schools being closed. But even if COVID ends quickly, which we're hoping for, we're still going to have a huge education problem. So within SDG 4, there's a target, SDG target 4.7. That says not only should there be good education, but there should be an education in two key themes. One is education in sustainable development, to learn about climate change, biodiversity, economic inequalities, all of the challenges that need to be confronted. And a second theme, learning about global citizenship, meaning learning that we're part of a whole world where people have different cultures, different religions, different traditions, and yet we should learn to live together, cooperate, be peaceful, mutually respectful. And so we need a culture of tolerance. And we don't have enough of that because it's so easy to stir up hate in our society. And we have whole news channels that are designed to stir up hate. That SDG 4.7 says, how about a little bit of cooperation? How about a little bit of tolerance? How about a little bit of mutual understanding so that we can work together? I see it today. I want us to work with China, not against China, for example. We have a lot of politicians say, that's the enemy, that's the enemy. But it's not so simple in this world just to point to someone and say, you're the enemy. We're perfect, you're the enemy. That is not really the right way to approach issues. So I very much believe, and Radhika very much believes, we're working on this together, that we need to get schools all over the world to say, yes, we're going to teach sustainable development. We're going to teach about climate change. We're going to teach about biodiversity. We're going to teach about ending poverty, and to teach about mutual respect and cooperation in global citizenship. And we've launched a mission 4.7, and we could get some of you to be good ambassadors for Mission 4.7, to help spread the word in your schools and in your communities that this is what everybody needs to learn. So I'm very optimistic about that. I think education is the single most powerful thing we can do to make a better world. It helps people in their own lives, but it also helps us to live together better, because we have so many prejudices and so many things we think are right that aren't right, that when we have education and scientific knowledge and a good evidence-based approach, we can solve so many important problems. That's really the goal. And what we're doing today, what you're doing this week, is really a great step forward. I also think, by the way, that if we use all this new Zooming possibility, well, students in New Jersey should be speaking with students in Ghana, speaking to students in China, speaking to students in Brazil. Get together and say, you know, you old people, get out of the way. We got it. We're going to do it. We know that this is possible. And for young people to connect around the world, face-to-face, e-face-to-e-face, digitally connect around the world, to talk about, okay, what are you guys doing in Sao Paulo about this? This is what's happening in New Jersey. Oh, you're doing that in Moscow? That's really interesting. Let's learn about what's happening in Delhi, and so on. So I think that this is a great opportunity for getting students to connect, even to do global projects together, where you have teams from 8 or 10 countries all working on a problem together. That would be a great way not only to learn about global citizenship, but to be a global citizen.
Thank you, Jeff. I think this was fantastic. I wish we had more of your time, 1 more hour, maybe 2 more hours, because we could continue asking questions and you have all the right answers for us so that we can, you know, get into action and make our work possible. But given the time limit, and I just want to be conscious of your time. Thank you.
Well, let me thank you and thank all the students. Thanks, guys, for really taking on these issues. This is great leadership. We're really with you, and we know your voice is really important. So reach out, you know, to your teachers in the school, in the community, to the mayor, to others. We've got to solve these problems. So we'll study them, we'll work on them, we'll come up with practical solutions.
Yeah, I just wanted to thank you again, Professor Sachs, for all of your responses. They were definitely really insightful. And I know as a young person, it definitely brings me a lot of hope moving forward, thinking about how much of an opportunity we have as youth to connect. And I hope that all the other young people listening today feel the same way.
Well, thank you. By the way, you're the one giving me hope. So it goes both directions. I really appreciate it.
Thank you. Yeah, that really means a lot to us.
Great.
So unfortunately, we don't have time to do an audience Q&A, but if anyone does have any questions regarding the conversation, you can definitely post them on the forum that we set up, and the planning team will definitely address them at future events. But thank you again so much, Professor Sachs.
Thank you. Bye-bye, everybody.
Thank you so much.
Have a wonderful session.
Thank you.
Great. Thank you so much, Navya, Ishan, Purva. That was fascinating to hear all the right questions and getting some answers from Professor Sachs. We'll move over to our panel. Our panelists have been waiting very patiently. I'm sorry about the flow of time here. I'll switch over to Hain. Hain is my colleague at the Center for Sustainable Development, and she will be moderating this session with Navya. Hain?
Thank you, Radhika. So our next session, we're going into the panel discussion that you have all been waiting for. Let me just make sure you can see my screen. Can you see the screen, everyone? Great. So for the first panel of the summit that I'm co-moderating with Navia here, we wanted to bring things together to paint a big picture on education for sustainable development. And the First Lady of New Jersey, Tammy Murphy, and Professor Jeffrey Sachs just laid a great foundation for us to really take our conversations forward. For this panel, we wanted to especially highlight things from the lens of climate justice, international education setting, as well as community engagement. And so to help us with this conversation, we have three esteemed panelists with us who are in the worlds of city government, township environmental commission, as well as researcher and practitioner, who are bringing their diverse expertise to merge it with education as a key component to understanding climate action. So our first panelist is Professor Andre Correa de Almeida, who is with the School of International and Public Affairs at Columbia University. He is the adjunct associate professor, as well as an assistant director to the Master of Public Administration and Development Practice Program. He has over 20 years of entrepreneurial, management, academic, and leadership experience in teaching, in research and consultancy capacities as well, all over the world. And you see some of the countries listed here. And in his diverse experiences, he has founded many education and data initiatives, which we'll get to discuss during the panel. So you'll get to hear more from him. He's also the senior advisor to the United Nations Development Program on program evaluation. And he's a regular contributor to Apolitical, Huffington Post, The Guardian, Publico, and you can follow him at the Twitter handle, which is shown on the screen as well. Our second panelist is Priya Patel. She's the chairperson of the Environmental Commission of Millburn, New Jersey. She has over 22 years of experience in health, development, and justice, both in the US and in India as well. And her career includes work in areas that range in diversity from community health education, gender-based violence, to water sanitation, and even urban farming. And her skills range from grant making, project management, and strategic planning to policy and participatory action research. And she has a master's of public health from University of Michigan. And our third panelist is Radley Faulkner, who is the AmeriCorps Vista with the Public Works Department of the City Government of Baltimore. So he has experience working in both public and private sectors, and his experiences expand in the areas of public relations, political campaigns, and community engagement. So he's a native of Baltimore, and he grew up observing the inequities that permeated the city. And he has been very passionate about wanting to change that and address that. So after getting his degree in history and political science from La Salle University, he returned home to work in the system. And since 2018, he has worked with the Baltimore-based community organizations like the Sixth Branch, Communities United, and Black Professional Men, engaging in projects that strengthen underserved communities. So he's currently with the Department of Public Works, and he is very passionate about conducting research and writing grants, all things that pertain to racial equity, community engagement, and environmental justice. And so with that, we're so excited to have these three panelists with us for our first conversation. So Navia, I will hand it over to you for the questions. And if I can ask the three panelists to come on screen.
Thank you so much for coming to speak with us. Just to reintroduce myself, my name is Navia. I am a sophomore at Newark Academy in New Jersey, and I'm also the high school co-chair for the New Jersey Student Sustainability Coalition. Just before we start, I wanted to let everyone know that we are hoping to have a quick Q&A with the audience at the end. So if you do have any questions throughout the time, please feel free to put them in the Q&A box. My first question is for Andre. So I wanted to ask, what were your key reasons for creating the Development Practice Lab at SIPA, and please feel free to comment on any other programs as well.
Sure, thank you. Thank you for the question, Navia, and thank you, Ian, for the wonderful introduction, and welcome to all of you. I don't know, it's so funny. I see 203 participants. 203 was my student number back in the primary school. So I always carry this 203 number very dearly and very close to my heart and mind. Actually reminding me where I was, I mean, clearly none of you are in the primary school, but it reminds me of my education process. So very, and now for some reason it's 202, so maybe. Anyway, thank you for having me. I'm so proud and glad to follow up to Jeffy Sachs' presentation, because I'm co-leading a program at SIPA that was created because of a Jeff Sachs idea. And that is also back in 2009. So Jeffy Sachs is an intellectual father of the Master in Development Practice, one of several Masters of Public Administration at SIPA, but the one that focused mostly on practice. And that was actually the reason why Development Practice Lab was created. Around 2011, 2 years after the program, the MPVP, the original master, was created, students were asking for more hands-on, practical type of work, which it was and it's still one of the key aspects in the 21st century education, high quality education system. And Jeff has been a champion of that effort to merge research with the attempts to apply and develop programs. So that was the reason why Development Practice Lab was created. It's a course, it's a three course. It started by being a 1.5 credit course. Now it's a 6 credit course. So it's really being expanding with the goal of letting students create a sort of a lab environment where students try to understand better the development problems, where they design interventions, where they actually implement some of those development interventions with partners that we partner either internationally and also in the Harlem area in Manhattan, and also the evaluation process. So that was, the DP Lab was created to further advance building practical components within the curriculum. And you asked me to elaborate and touch on other aspects of my work. And so one of the, I think, the beauties of the program that I co-run with my colleague Glenn Denning is that we bring all the faculty and staff, actually bring to the classroom and to SIPA both the traditional academic tradition, the traditional academic role in terms of research, publishing, papers, books, conferences, et cetera, but also we all have a very strong field component in our background. And that's what we try to marry in these Masters of Development Practice, is the research, and many of the research actually comes from our Earth Institute colleagues, and the Center for Sustainable Development has been one of the key strategic partners at the Earth Institute for us, merging that research with practice. That's the reason why DP Lab was created.
Great. So just following up on that, from these programs you have created and managed, especially for learning and research, do you have any tips for our audience on how they should go about approaching their own learning for real life challenges and issues of our time, such as climate change?
Yes. So I advise, I'm the academic advisor of all students in my program. So in any given year, I advise 100 students, and we have hundreds of applications coming every year. So one of the things that I strongly encourage students and prospective candidates when they think about the school, and SIPA is certainly not the only school that offer great programs around the world. So I try to be very fair in my advising role, is to find an educational program that connects you with the real world, that brings into the curriculum opportunities to do capstones or internships or case studies. We heavily use case studies in our curriculum. So I'm repeating a little bit what I said in my first answer, just to emphasize the role of practice. And note that the practice was never viewed as such as a novel activity as it is now. a few centuries ago, not many centuries ago, practice was viewed as like a minor activity, where the most novel activities were philosophy and history and languages and, you know, history. Practice was always viewed as sort of a less obvious candidate to be as useful as it is now for the development world. And I want to build upon something that Jeff said. Jeff mentioned multiple times the issue of tolerance. And I love the fact that the 17 SDG is about global partnerships. Maybe you did not think about it, but I love that the 17th SDG, which is the last SDG, that talks about global partnerships. And I like it so much because it points to the importance of trust building and reciprocity among stakeholders, kind of suggesting that no matter what you do with the other 16 goals, education, health, climate change, infrastructure, cities, no matter what you achieve in those at the scientific level in those goals, if you do not build the trust and the language and the communication capacity to build these global partnerships, global or local, frankly, it's global and local. I work a lot with mayors and city urban innovation, and those partnerships are equally important. But so I would emphasize that before I talked about practice and multidisciplinary approaches, my last thought to answer your question is this focus on trust building and reciprocity. I always encourage our students to take classes, language classes, to take classes on conflict and negotiation, conflict resolution, classes on communication skills, classes on that are more very often not viewed as obvious candidates for classes in a development program, but are critical if we want to build bridges, regional, international bridges for development.
Thank you. That's really insightful and really helpful. So my final question for you would just be, from what you have observed in your extensive academic research and practitioner experiences, how do you think various institutions, academic, political, business, however you want to see it, can help to not only raise awareness, but also effectively facilitate behavior change for climate action and climate education?
Practice. I mean, and what do I mean by practice? Practice means it's a process where the traditional academia is very good in identifying problems, right? Problems, gaps, opportunities for improvement. You know, the traditional academia is very, very strong on that. So in social sciences, mostly. Other are the fields of knowledge have a larger tradition in practice. I mean, medicine have a very strong tradition in practice for centuries, right? In social sciences, that it was not always the case. In certain fields of social sciences, such as anthropology, and in for a long time in sociology, the scientist was for the most part an observer. And actually, anthropology, you are not supposed to interfere in the context. Like a hardcore traditional anthropologist observes, take notes, writes, take pictures. That has been changing a lot over the centuries and decades. We need to understand what works and what does not work. And that's not achieved in a faculty or office. That's achieved in labs. That's achieved in rather controlled environments that we call labs to try and experiment and fail and try again, right? So I think, I kept repeating myself in all your questions because you ask very important questions, and all of them have this common element in it, which is the element of practice. And practice also connects with trust, because how do we build trust in our, at school, in our families? We build trust through going together, through experiences. We build trust by experiencing sharing challenges and together trying to address them. And so that's why practice is not only about designing an idealized outcome, but it's also about the way to engage a community of a group of experts or stakeholders in the process. So that's what's practice. Practice is not only about optimization of a certain formula or of a certain equation or of a certain idea. There's a lot built around the process through which partners or friends or colleagues go together. And what Jeff was talking about, the relationships between the US and China, it's that. We need to refine ways, and I'm just using some of Jeff's analogies, US and China, but we could talk about neighboring cities. We could talk about companies operating in the same industry. There's a lot that we need to learn regarding how we build trust, because without that building trust, we'll not be able to build the global and local partnerships needed for behavioral change. And sometimes we talk about behavioral change, it is like changing the community's behavior, like, you know, the homeless's behavior, or the, you know, the single mom's behavior. But there's a lot of behavior that needs to be changed at the CEO level, at the prime minister level, at the government level. So when thinking about behavioral change, don't think about behavioral change only in terms of the targeted or the communities, as we normally do sometimes call it. Think about behavioral change across all levels of players.
Thank you. That was really insightful. I think I really have a new definition of the word. My next questions are for Ms. Patel. And I wanted to ask, so under your environmental commission, Millburn's single-use plastic ordinance successfully passed. So what do you think were some key reasons why this ordinance was able to pass? And do you think education played a role in it?
Thanks for the time. So I think in brief, I think the ordinance passed because people showed up. You know, people showed up at meetings. People basically voiced their support for this ordinance at township committee meetings. They got engaged in education efforts, and basically it's just about showing up. I really believe that. I mean, there's a reason why climate policy right now is reflective of people that are probably, you know, older and richer. It's because the people that are maybe from, you know, Black and brown communities that are low income, maybe because they're working or they don't have time perhaps to show up at these meetings. And I think that, you know, when we got kids to show up at meetings and hold up signs and talk about why they wanted this plastics ordinance, we were able to get it passed. Timing, I think, played a big role. But overall, I really think it's about finding your voice and expressing it and letting people hear it and let them know that, you know, the powers that be aren't necessarily the only ones that have a stake in this. And we have to educate them and let them know that we exist and we're here and we have a right to, you know, have a say in what we want our future to look like as it pertains to the climate crisis.
Thank you. That I completely agree. I think youth action once again is so important. So was there any resistance from local businesses? How were your committee and Millburn's community able to work with the resistance?
You know, there was some resistance, but I think that's where the voices played a, you know, had an impact. So I cannot stress enough the importance of just showing up and letting your voice be heard, because, you know, I think that it was very easy to kind of chip away at people's opposition when we talked about the larger issue of all this plastic waste that's polluting our waterways, that's being burned in Black and brown communities. In our case, in Essex County, it goes to the Covanta incinerator in Newark. So I think when we highlighted that issue with kids, it sort of appealed to their, you know, kind of playground sensibility of, you know, what's fair. And, you know, that's not fair. It's not fair to use something or, you know, waste something or whatever in one area and then throw it away, dispose of it somewhere else. I mean, that's inherently unfair. That's inherently unjust. And I think when we framed this issue of plastic waste in sort of the larger issue of justice, it resonated. It made a lot of sense. And, you know, I think that that resonated with a lot of the folks that were perhaps opposing this ordinance. It made them think, well, you know, is it, do I really need to be able to sell my coffee in styrofoam cups? Like, is it really that important? Can I make a change? Is it worth it to make the change? And I'd like to think that they thought that it was worth it to make the change.
Yeah, I think that brings up a really important point on environmental justice and how it's it's at the front and center of climate action, especially for youth and especially in organizations that I work with. So considering I work in a youth organization, do you have some tips you can share with youth on managing resistance or setbacks related to climate change?
I do, but you know, I feel like if there's somebody out there that can say it better than me, I would always defer to them. And I asked the organizers of this event to share a poem from one of my favorite poets, Gwendolyn Brooks, and hopefully they'll be able to share the screen. I feel like Gwendolyn Brooks just nailed it. And this is something that's always been something that I refer to when I feel like it's too hard. You know, when there's self-soilers, harmony hushers, downkeepers, I feel like it's worth it in the end. So, you know, it's gonna be tough. You're gonna have people tell you that you're wrong, that it's too hard, it's impossible, it's not worth it. But it's important to find other people, other like-minded folks that are supporting you. And to kind of take the long view and to know that it's a tough fight, but it's worth it.
Definitely. Thank you so much for speaking. My last questions are gonna be for Mr. Faulkner. So you have a bit of a different perspective in the way that you are not from New Jersey or New York. So my first question is, why did the Department of Public Works in Baltimore start a community engagement program for the eco/environmental cause? And what are the greatest environmental issues in Baltimore?
Okay, first off, panelists, moderators, attendees, I'm really honored to be here amongst such esteemed panelists like yourself. So first off, I just want to say thank you guys, and I'm just honored to be here. My first point is the reason why we decided to start this program is because there's a multitude of adverse factors impacting residents of Baltimore. What we call cumulative impacts, right? Cumulative impacts basically refers to the various adverse factors such as social economic status, location, and also the environment that affect, you know, your social determinants of health. I'm gonna go back a little bit deeper here though. A lot of this stems from the racial redlining and discrimination that has occurred in Baltimore. So in around the 1900s, going up until now, in the early days, there was like Blacks and brown people and immigrants as well, they were redlined, right? So they couldn't get houses in good areas. So they were placed in the area where, you know, there was a lot of pollution and the water quality wasn't good. And this has continued to today. If you look at the maps of the areas of Baltimore where the areas are like really bad, it's in the communities that are redlined. And those communities a lot of times have to deal with a lot of pollution, a lot of bad air quality. The water is not as good. The infrastructure is not as good. On top of that, you don't have grocery stores. So all these factors come together to really create like a deadly cocktail, if you will, of factors that you know, really pollute the environment and allow, don't allow these communities to thrive. So the reason why we wanted to create this environmental ambassadors program was because we just wanted to start combating that, right? Like under the Trump administration, there was more than 100 environmental rollbacks. And last year was really just a big kind of turning point, because with the whole George Floyd incident and just the move towards racial equity, we really got even more of a push for that. So that's just something we want to, you know, instill in the community, racial equity through educating the residents about environmental injustices and how they can help to, lessen those, mitigate those, and improve their communities.
Yeah.
So I'm all over the place a little bit there.
No, that's actually perfect, because it kind of ties into the next question, or might as well be an answer for it, but are there any climate justice issues that the department needs to take into special consideration?
Okay. Like I said, there's a myriad of things going on right now. Most recently, Baltimore, we had like a historical lawsuit or historical litigation against the big, fossil fuel companies. What was it? BP, Shell, Exxon, Chevron. We took them to the Supreme Court, and we tried to basically hold a litigation against them on the basis that they contributed to climate change and they knew about it. And not just them, but there's other companies as well. Like, for example, the Wheeler Brader, which is a big deal. It's very controversial in our city because that's where the trash is burned. And many years they said the Wheeler Brader should have been shut down. And it's like, I've talked to many people about it, and it's because they have so much power, and the people and the living in those areas who are facing the pollution, they don't have as much power, right? These are big companies, Dutch, you know, Shell, BP, Exxon. So like I said, just that combined with the cumulative impacts. I said, direct with this question, but just as there's a lot that's going on, right? The climate change contributes to the heat islands that we see in the city. So you have many areas, like I said, the red line areas where there's no tree canopy. So since there's no tree canopy, when it comes to summertime, those areas get berated with heat, and that contributes to asthma and other you know, factors and stuff like that. Like according to the Office of Minority Health in 2014, blacks were three times higher to die from asthma cases than whites. And a lot of that stems from, you know, being in areas where there's heat islands, where there's no tree canopy. Those are a couple issues that are going on right now that we're trying to target.
That's great. No, I never knew about that. And please don't ever apologize for not being direct, because all the information you give is just so informative and so great. But my final question is just, how do you think community engagement, specifically considering the programs you started, can help solve these issues? And is there a role that education can play in this endeavor?
Okay, all right. So I like to, one of our counterparts is Dr. Sokobe Wilson from University of Maryland. Part of what we're trying to do is also just forming partnerships, right? Forming partnerships. We have multiple partnerships in the community with different community organizations in the neighborhood. On top of that, we have multiple partnerships with bodies like Johns Hopkins, the big ones, Morgan State, University of Maryland. We're trying to get more of a push for public health and improving that area in Baltimore. And like I said, Dr. Sokobe Wilson said, anybody can be a scientist. I wrote that in one of my articles. He said, anybody can be a scientist. And that's what we're trying to do. One of the methods that we took from him is something called community-based participatory research. Basically, that means when you allow the people in the area to be involved in the experiments that are going on, or the observations that are going on. So allow the people to be involved in, you know, air pollution monitoring. Allow them to be involved in water sampling. Right. You have to allow them to be involved in these experiments and just understand the environmental side of things and what are the ramifications of it. So I'd say, yeah, just having an environmental ambassadors program and educating the residents about these type of things can be a big deal to help them to, you know, advance the system.
Great, thank you so much for speaking. And I wanna thank all the panelists for speaking. And if anyone wants the link to some of the articles that Mr. Faulkner wrote, we put them in the presentation, but I will also put the link in the chat as soon as possible. Thank you for also sharing some information about the cumulative impacts bill, which is a great environmental justice bill. And I know a lot of youth organizations had some work in getting that passed. I know at least NJSSC, the organization I work with, we created call scripts and did a couple of drives to local assemblymen to get that passed. So I don't see questions unless I don't know. But I see a question for Mr. Faulkner. Would you mind talking a bit about the infamous lead paint study in Baltimore as a case of environmental racism?
I'm pretty sure it's 1993 to 2005. I did a case study on this. Basically, they found that you know, much of the lead paint was, like I said, in the areas where, you know, many of the minorities lived. Like I said, there's something called the Baltimore butterfly. Basically, that states that like all the areas, it's like kind of like if you look at Baltimore, it's a map. Basically, the same clustered areas that forms a butterfly, and these are all the same impoverished areas that are underserved, that, you know, obviously a lot of times don't get looked at. And these are the areas that where you find much of the lead paint, you know, problems. Like West Baltimore, Freddie Gray, he grew up facing that problem, and that really affected his outlook on life and just his development. Like, he didn't finish, you know, high school and things like that because like the lead paint really affected his mental perception and just his ability to really be successful in a classroom environment. So I'm not going to talk too much about the lead statistics because I don't have them on hand, but yeah, that's kind of like a short snippet.
Thank you. Just because we don't have a ton of time, I'm gonna move on to a question for Professor Correa Del Maida. Reflecting on your career working to study and practice development strategies, what were some major pitfalls you and your collaborators faced when building inter and intra community trust?
I think there are two challenges. One is language. You know, we the most important partnerships and alliances should cut across multiple disciplines. But that's difficult to have social scientists talk the language of data scientists. For example, I'm involved in I created a network of data scientists and computer scientists to fight corruption in my home country, Portugal. And we have data scientists building algorithms, but the algorithms need to understand the law. The algorithms need to be taught about the laws that prevent and fight corruption. So you need the legal experts and the social scientists helping the data scientists convert the legal law into coding instructions. So that's one difficulty. And that difficult then becomes even more difficult these days because we operate in a permanent state of urgency. And trust building requires time. Trust building requires interaction, right? And so on one end, you have the need to understand one another in different technical languages. But on the other end, we are pressured by quick wins and deliverables. So that's one thing. One type of difficulty that we faced. The other one is we need to build new incentive systems. I mean, I joined the conversation during the Yellowstone pipeline question for Jeffrey Sachs. And the question was very important because you have two positive goals, which is economic development, even though it may be viewed as a short-term economic development, and environmental protection. No one can question these goals, but they are conflicting in this particular case. Even though in the long run, one may say that it's not economically wise to invest in one way or the other, The truth is that in the short run, that would produce some benefits. But still, the question is the trade-offs. So I think this is the second truly true difficulty, is to find an incentive system that aligns the interests of different stakeholders. And I mean, look at our family structure, our difficulty is sometimes to find a place to spend the weekend, or our difficulty is to decide where to go for dinner or lunch. So that's why I always think that we should have neuroscientists and brain scientists in these conversations, because they are the best persons to help us, and communication experts as well. They are the best persons to help us understand how can we shape the message? How can we shape the discussions to allow for trust building and reciprocity to happen more smoothly? So anyway, answer to your question, two things, language issue and incentive system issue.
Thank you. Just before we wrap up, there is a follow-up question. Upon reflection, what common threads exist between the successful trust building strategies? What recommendations do you have for students seeking to build trust to advance environmental reforms in their local communities in addition to partner schools internationally?
Wow. Well, I would say that build your social skills and build your technical skills. So this is like one-on-one. There was a time not long ago, 20 years ago, maybe the second half of the 20th century was mostly driven by the technical element. I think as we try to develop more complex alliances, international alliances, UN, NATO, European Union, you know, you name it, there's the issue of language becomes more critical, language, social skills. So social skills and technical skills. And the other idea would be we really need to continue our learning process throughout life, because it's connected with the social skill. It's connected with language. But if we want to be in my program, we train students to become leaders. And by leaders, meaning folks that are capable of building teams with social scientists, data scientists, medical doctors, engineers, you know, you name it. And for that, you really need to learn a little bit of a multiple technical languages. And that requires not only one degree, not only one master's, and frankly, not only one PhD. And if this conversation is to be based on my experience, I think that we need to move ourselves out of our comfort zones. And I never work on data science. And all of a sudden I'm running a national network of data scientists together with technologists and social scientists. So it's not easy, because when you enter the room with the data scientists and computer scientists, you feel very small. You feel very small. I mean, you fear not having the right words to say or not having the right questions. But if at least you can have the problem, if you can help shape the problem or shape the research question or shape the development question, then you're already helping the team work together.
That's really insightful. Thank you. Just one final question for Ms. Patel. Considering you are working in politics and you are a woman, what difficulties do you face as a woman in politics and in government and when trying to push these policies through?
That's an interesting question. I think that there are some preconceived notions around who participates in environmental work in New Jersey. That's been my experience. I've worked in India, I've worked in Chicago, and I do think that the the community here in New Jersey tends to be older and less diverse, meaning like less Black and Brown folks and less people from, you know, lower socioeconomic groups. There's also kind of a focus, I think, on preservation and conservation, but not necessarily justice and righting the wrongs or looking at the kinds of issues that I think Radley alluded to. So I think it's been a lot of reframing for me in terms of, you know, when we talk about education, I think that kind of zooming the lens out for folks and letting them know that this is an issue that kind of extends beyond making sure trails and parks are maintained and parks are preserved. And it's about, pollution and fairness and cumulative impacts. So I don't know if necessarily it's been people have treated me differently because I'm a woman or a woman of color, but I do think that it's been a bit of an uphill battle in terms of sort of reframing the issue of climate and environmentalism as more of a justice issue, as that's been my experience.
Thank you so much. I think that's a great way to wrap up this panel. Following this, I want to thank first all three panelists for speaking with us today. And following this, we will be having a workshop with Frida and Bianca, the founders of The Green Cause. So I will hand it over to Hayen to introduce them.
Great, thank you so much. And thank you again to the three panelists. It was, it's so refreshing to hear from experts who are working on the ground. And so really thank you for your insights today and for, you know, lending to all your previous experiences as well as your personal experiences to kind of kick us off on this summit, this week-long summit. So we hope these conversations continue and we'll be definitely getting back in touch with you with other questions that we received from the attendees even after the session. So thank you so much. Thank you. So now if I can, given that we're a little bit behind time, if you need to just quickly like run to the restroom or grab, you know, a cup of water, please feel free to do that. But we don't want to delay too much. So we want to start with our workshop. And we have Frida Ruiz with us and Bianca Palomino with us. So we'll just give it 1 minute while for people to just, you know, do a quick, since we've been on for a little bit now, just to quickly for a water break, just 1 minute, and then we will start with the workshop and then I will do the introductions. Thank you. So we will get started with our workshop called Around the World. We're so excited to have our two workshop facilitators today who are also the co-founders of The Green Cause. First, we have Frida Ruiz with us. She's a high school senior attending the Sustainable Sciences program at Union County Vocational Technical High School. She was inspired to create an outlet where students are able to be educated on environmental issues in her local community, where she was noticing that many of her peers were acting carelessly towards the environment. So The Green Cause is an outlet for members to teach youth to understand the importance of the environment and how they can make a difference. And she hopes to one day work at a renewable energy facility as an engineer. And we have our second facilitator with us, Bianca Palomino. She's a senior at the same high school as Rita. And it seems like the school is producing a lot of brilliant minds, as we can see from our two facilitators. Bianca has a growing passion for the environment, aligning with various missions ahead of her. And this includes the short-term goal of educating her own community and the long-term goal of educating the nation on the critical issues that is the environment. So these goals are being met through a student-led initiative about the green cause. And we can definitely hear more on that from the two facilitators. And Bianca hopes to major in environmental biology to cultivate her knowledge further. So now I will hand over to you for the workshop. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you for such a beautiful introduction. So yes, I'm Bianca, and my partner here for this project is Frida. We will explain about the green cause a little later in the presentation. We have broken down this life around the world into two types of subjects. So first is the marine biodiversity, which is what Frida's going to address. And then I will take over with terrestrial. We were told that this workshop is meant for the youth. So maybe you can bring out your inner child or just, you know, learn something new in our workshop. So I'll pass it over to Frida.
Yeah, so again, thank you for the wonderful introduction and something to preface before we get started with the workshop is a lot of the time, the whole purpose of the Green Cause is to create this educational content. And what's better than to tell you how we create this educational content than to show you a sample of our types of presentations. So you can move to the next slide, sorry. So to first start it off, what is biodiversity? So biodiversity in simple terms, it's just the variety of life on Earth. However, there are different kinds of biodiversity. You know, the next slide. Okay, so there's species diversity, which is among species present in different ecosystems. And this is the diversity of populations of organisms and species and the way that they interact. So even though the picture is a bit small, as you can see, there is kind of like a lake ecosystem, and there are different animals surrounding it and plants. It's just the way that they all interact in that ecosystem kind of describes species biodiversity. Then you have genetic biodiversity, which is diversity of genes within a species and processes like mutations that occur. So even though in that picture they're all adorable dogs, they're all different kinds of dogs. So that kind of explains that type of biodiversity. Then you have ecosystem biodiversity. And as you can see in that picture, it's all the different types of biomes. And it's the type of diversity in a given region and the way that they interact with their immediate environment. So there are animals and plants that are living in those biomes and the way that they all interact with that biome and the resources and maybe the advantages and disadvantages that those biomes give to those organisms and the way that they have to adapt. And then lastly, functional diversity, which consists of energy flow and matter cycling. And as you can see with that food chain, you see that even though like you can't see it, like they're passing off energy is what the animal or plant relies on living. And just a quick thing to mention as well is biodiversity not only depends on the different varieties of organisms, but also how many of those kinds of organisms, because both factors are extremely important to gauging how much biodiversity there is in a biome. Okay, go to the next slide. All right, so the first thing, like Bianca mentioned, I will be talking about marine ecosystems. So before we get started with all of that, I just wanted to give a throwback, and I bet all of you remember Finding Nemo, and then you'll be able to see all the different kinds of fish and plants in this little clip.
Looks over the mollusk and says, with friends like these, who needs anemones?
Whoa, Nemo, who's this?
Exchange student. I'm from the EAC, dude.
Sweet.
Totally.
But seriously, Marty, did you really do all the things you say you did?
Pardon me. Don't be alarmed.
Oh, we just wanted to make sure that our newest member got home safe.
Thanks, guys.
We'll see you next week.
Keep up with the program, Dory.
Remember, fish are friends.
Not food. Bye.
Hold on. Here we go. Next up, knowledge.
Bye, son. Have fun.
Bye, guys. Oh, Mr. Ray, wait, I forgot something. Love you, Dad.
I love you too, son.
Dad, you can let go now.
Sorry. Now go have an adventure.
As you can see from that very wholesome ending, throughout the scene, there were different kinds of animals. There, you could see sea turtles, different fish, there were even sharks. So it all just makes up that ecosystem. So the first marine ecosystem that I wanted to talk about was an estuary, and it's a coastal zone where oceans meet rivers. Nutrients and salts from the ocean mix with those from the river and placed sheltered from extreme weather, and the water mix from the river and the ocean kind of make what is called brackish water, a mix of seawater and freshwater. And it's among one of the most productive places on life and supports many types of life, and especially provides a nursery for many kinds of species, especially the ones who wouldn't automatically be able to survive in the open ocean. They have traditionally supported many human communities and activities like fishing, shipping, and transportation. And in general, they're important because they maintain water quality by filtering toxic pollutants, excess plant nutrients, and sediments. They provide food, habitats, and again, like I mentioned before, nurseries for different species. Next, I wanted to talk a bit about mangrove forests. And they're also found in more tropical areas. These ecosystems frequently flood with ocean water, submerging the roots of the mangrove trees and then filtering out the salt. These trees provide a home for a variety of species such as fish, crabs, shrimp, reptiles, and amphibians. And then last, the ocean ecosystem, which can be sort of divided into two parts. The open ocean, which has more of the deeper parts like the benthal and abyssal layer, and then the euphotic zone / coral reef zone. So just to talk a bit about the ocean itself, it makes up 71% of the Earth's surface. Less than 5% of the water plant ocean has been explored. And like I mentioned before, it varies widely as the depth of the ocean changes. So just to talk a bit about more the deeper parts of the ocean. So the abyssal and benthal zone, like I mentioned before, they're both cold, have high pressure, little oxygen, and the deeper the ocean goes, the more sorts of adaptations that the organisms need to take, for example, taking on bioluminescence. And also more of towards the lighter parts of the ocean, there are extremely diverse ecosystems that host sponges, mollusks, fish, turtles, sharks, dolphins, and many more. And there are a lot of the world's producers near the surface as there is more light. And then we are here to talk a bit more about the marine keystone species. And for those who don't know, keystone species is a species that is absolutely integral to the ecosystem. And if their population starts to dwindle, it affects all the other parts of the ecosystem. So first up, we have coral reefs, and they're made up of stony corals called polyps. And then they have a symbiotic relationship with tiny algae. And a symbiotic relationship just means that both parties mutually benefit from the relationship that they have. And what happens is there are first the polyps that kind of float into a surface, and then they start to solidify. And yes, they technically can get food by absorbing the sediment and the debris that goes by towards the ocean, but would be a lot easier for them is to have these microscopic algae make the food so they can get food. And then in return, the microscopic algae get protection and a home. So why are they so important? Well, coral reefs are very important because they are habitat of 25%, one-fourth of all marine life. They are a natural barrier protecting coastlines. They support ecotourism and one-tenth of all fisheries. Their ecosystems provide a source of new medicines. For example, certain algae and sea sponges can provide drugs to treat cancer. What are sharks? Sharks are a type of fish, which means that they are cold-blooded and use gills to breathe. And they are less harmful than perceived, as us humans tend to kill millions of sharks a year, while it was reported that yearly sharks only kill 20 humans. And why are they important for the ecosystem? They're just some top predators, right? Well, exactly. They play an essential role in the ocean's ecosystem by keeping the food web in balance. As they are top predators, they maintain fish population by eating them, and they ensure to get rid of sick fish that may spread diseases in fish colony. And they also serve as ecological indicators, which means that they kind of show a reflection of how healthy that environment is. And they also have antibacterial properties in their tissue, which could be used to kill some viruses and even cystic fibrosis. And ecotourism, which is swimming with sharks, can bring in 340 million annually worldwide. And then we have sea turtles, which are reptiles, which again, they are also cold-blooded and they tend to lay eggs. And then they are also highly migratory, which means that they move around the ocean for different specific reasons. So either for mating or for feeding. And basically, sea turtles are so important because they can break down energy of plant material and convert it into proteins. Sea turtles are prey for other animals at all stages of life. Hatchlings are prey for birds, crabs, land mammals, and fish. Adult sea turtles are prey for apex predators like sharks and orca, and their nesting helps beaches as the opened eggs left behind tend to help coastal vegetation, and they graze on the seagrass, which helps the seagrass as that movement that the sea turtles do is known to help it grow. And then they also help the economy towards ecotourism. And then lastly, we have plankton. So these are the most common types of plankton, phytoplankton, which are producers and account for half the global's primary production, and then zooplankton, which could also be known as consumers. So plankton are very important because they have many predators like whales relying on them for food. And like I mentioned before, phytoplankton can do biogeochemical cycles like photosynthesis, as they can turn carbon into organic compounds. And just to mention, not all of them are as good, as some may produce harmful byproducts like some type of algae, but most of them are good. And especially the phytoplankton that are really integral and are really the foundation of many marine food webs and food chains. So obviously, you know, before we move on to the terrestrial side, you know, question time. So you can type in the chat which keystone species you learned something new about, something that really shocked you, or even if you knew everything that we had presented, maybe just type in your favorite keystone species. We can give around 15 seconds to get some results. So you have coral reefs, sea turtles, sharks, or plankton, as they are all important to the ocean, but we definitely want to see what you learned. And then if you learned, if you knew everything, then what did you really like? I love this variety of answers. Everyone's included here. Alrighty, so as more answers start coming in, we can move on to terrestrial biomes.
So hi everyone, I hope you guys enjoyed Frida's segment, but now we're gonna try and get into the land. Okay, so next slide, please. So here's some just quick facts to get into the mood. So it makes up approximately 30% of planet Earth, which is opposed to the 70% that is covered in water. 86% of plant biomass is held by land, so because of the trees, which are terrestrial, among other plants. Most plants and animals are found in rainforests, which holds the most biodiversity. We'll get to that. And not all deserts are hot, so we'll talk about that too. Next slide, please. So what even is a biome to begin with? Well, it's a physical environment that has specific characteristics and species that share the same adaptations. So how many general biomes are there? Well, today we're going to talk about three general biomes and break them up into little themes or more specified so that we can understand them better. Next slide, please. So first is grasslands. We have two types. The first is the savanna. So it would be a completely missed opportunity not to show a small clip of the Lion King. And just to, before the clip, we are going to stop it at 2 minutes just because it's a little longer than the other ones. So I'm playing it.
Through this veil.
That's perfect. Yes, thank you. So now let's get into some facts about what we've just seen. So the climate there, the climate there ranges from 50 to 90 degrees Celsius through the 12 months, and they receive about 20 to 50 inches of rain per year. Their trees have a thick bark and deep roots and sometimes a toxic sap to keep those animals away. Some examples include the candelabra tree, which is on the right-hand side on the corner, not the bird yet, the river bushfellow, and the whistling thorn, which is on the left-hand side on the top corner. They're really spiky. So animal species include the baobab trees and elephants. And what's interesting about them is that during the dry months, elephants, although they can migrate, they also tend to kind of use their strength against the baobab trees and suck out all the water that they hold from the trunk. Then there's the fork-tailed drongos, little spelling error, my apologies, using the fires to their advantage, they eat the roasted insects that are left over. And then additionally burrowing animals, and they often go underground until the flames above them disperse. Next slide, please. Okay, then it's a temperate grassland. So this is the second type of grassland. This climate can reach over 100 degrees Fahrenheit, and winters can reach to negative 40 degrees Fahrenheit. Annual average precipitation is from 10 to 35 inches. They have extremely fertile soil and are home to many grasses. The foxtail and buffalo grass being some examples can survive fires because they have deep underground stems and buds. Additionally, you'll find those sunflowers and wild indigos. Animal species include ungulates, which are mammals that have hooves, like the bison, antelope, and then the prairie dogs and coyotes. Now we move on to deserts. This is the second of the generalized biomes. There are three types that we're going to talk about. Okay, tropical desert. The tropical desert is the one that we know most about. It's the hottest one. It has reached up to 136 degrees Fahrenheit and can go down to 32 degrees Fahrenheit in the night. Rainfall is sparse, and sometimes there's no rainfall at all to be recorded annually. Some plant species to talk about and how they survive is that in this climate, they have thick leaves. And one of the examples is a barrel cactus, which you see on the left-hand side, and a creosote bush, which there's no picture here. And then there are also animal species, and some that I found interesting was the Mojave rattlesnake, which is on the top, camels, and that is, I believe, an armadillo lizard. And now this is the temperate desert. So this is a little bit in the middle. So there are hot summers, 95 degrees Fahrenheit, and cold winters with a minimum of 24 degrees Fahrenheit. There's more rain in the winter months, of course, compared to the tropical desert, and the annual average precipitation is about 6 to 10 inches. Some plant species are the trees, and they have really long roots to reach for water, and also an adaptation that was cool is that they have silver leaves, some of them. And some examples include the sagebrush, rabbit brush, and pinyon pine. Those kind of brushes you'll see in a landscape like the one shown. Some animal species are the goby bears, and unfortunately they are endangered. What's so unique about the goby bears is that they are the only bears to live in a desert type biome. Next is the Bactrian camel, and it has two humps instead of the traditional one hump, as you can see in the picture. Next slide, please. Next is the cold desert. So this is what I was talking about in the beginning. So there can be a cold desert. In the winter, it can go from 30 to 40 degrees Fahrenheit, and the summer is 7 to 80 degrees Fahrenheit. Average yearly precipitation ranges, unfortunately, I cannot see it. Hopefully you guys can. But the rest of that will fall as snow, and it can actually reach to 25 inches of snow there. Plant species include plants that only grow up to 6 to 48 inches. So an example of that would be lichen, which is a type of moss. So imagine this very low plants that can't grow very high. And plants do shed their leaves or have spiny leaves. There are only 14 to 41 individuals per hectare, which is as big as a soccer field, which is a lot of space for only a few individuals. And some examples are jackrabbits, kangaroo, and mice. The cold deserts are also known as a tundra. And a main characteristic of a tundra is the freeze and thaw cycles of the soil. So depending on the temperatures, the soil will freeze and then it'll thaw out and it'll freeze again. It's just a cycle. Next slide, please. Okay, so now forests are my personal favorite. This is the third general biome we'll talk about, and it has three types as well. All right, so the temperate forest has a climate that reaches 70 degrees Fahrenheit, while winter can go below freezing, and below freezing is 32 degrees Fahrenheit. Temperate forest is where I live, or maybe where you live too, and I live in New Jersey, so I see a lot of these trees. Average annual precipitation is from 30 to 60 inches. Some plant species are the deciduous trees. They pretty much dominate this biome. The deciduous trees are the ones that change color in the fall, and their leaves fall and then grow back again in the summer. Examples of these trees include maple, oaks, and birch trees. Animal species include bears. We all know the bears, right? Because they hibernate during the colder months, and they still have the thick fur, of course, to be able to withstand the low temperatures. And that's actually extremely important in this type of biome, because this biome has the four seasons. So anything that decides to live here needs to be able to withstand all four seasons. Other animals include cougars, bobcats, badgers, and mice. Now, this is a cold desert. It's also known as a taiga or a boreal forest. There's little rain or snow that, although when it does snow, snow a lot. Temperatures range from negative 65 to 30 degrees Fahrenheit. Plant species include coniferous trees and have needles that never fall off. These needles have a waxy covering to protect them from the cold temperatures. And these needles never fall off, because the minute they can do photosynthesis, they will. Animal species, most animals of the taiga tend to be predators, such as the lynx, minx, and bobcats. Lynx is featured on the right-hand side, and they hunt for red squirrels and snowshoe rabbits, which the rabbit is shown on the right-hand side as well. Okay, so now we're getting into the rainforest. I hope that we're able to play this clip. Let's give it a shot.
Thank you.
Okay, so no worries. That wasn't a spoiler. That was the beginning of the movie. So if you would like to see it, I do recommend. I think that sets us up for the rainforest. I thought it was vital that we spend a little more time on the rainforest because it has the most biodiversity. Because of its temperature. It has 70 to 85 degrees Fahrenheit with high humidity, 77% to 88% humidity. And that allows for more animals to be able to live here. There's a high amount of rainfall from 80 to 400 inches annually, which is a lot of rain. And it's made up of four key layers, as you can see on the right-hand side. There's the emergent layer, upper canopy, understory, and forest floor. What's interesting about this is that only 2% sunlight reaches the ground floor because of the thickness of the canopy. And that means that the plants on the bottom don't grow as tall as the trees would when they reach the top. Okay, next is the plant species. So the Malaysian rainforest trees provide calanolide A, which is medicine used to battle HIV. And that's the white flower that's on the slide. The rubber tree, which is in the center, collecting in a little bowl, is a tree that obviously provides rubber from its bark, and it's actually how we still make rubber today. Next is the cacao tree. That's all the way to the left side. These are super nutritious and delicious. They have more calcium than cow's milk and actually have more iron than any other plant found. And next is the coffee plant. Who doesn't like a nice cup of coffee? First, this plant gives out a flower. The flowers fall off and then the berries grow. And inside the berries is where you find the coffee beans we know and love. Okay, next are the animal species. So first we have the mountain gorilla. The mountain gorilla usually travels in a pack of 30, and its leader is usually called a silverback. Next is the okapis. These are the closest relatives to giraffes that are known as of today, and they have stripes and because of that are masters of camouflage, which you can see right above the gorilla. Next are brown-throated three-toed sloths, tongue twister. These are actually extremely slow. They can grow algae on their fur, and it actually takes a month to digest a meal. Next are jaguars. They prey on about 85 species in the rainforest. That includes armadillos and birds. And this also includes snatching fish and turtles out of the water, which is a skill that I didn't know they had. Next is scarlet macaws. An interesting fact about them is that they are one of the few animals that are known to mate for life. And you also have that strong beak to break open nuts and seeds. And lastly, but of course not the least, is the green anacondas. They are known to be the heaviest snake in all of the world, and they can reach up to 500 pounds. Their length can reach up to 30 feet as well. All right, so I would not be able to talk about rainforests without addressing the human impact. So deforestation is obviously something that is done for human reasons, right? Ranching, making space for households, civilizations, and this taking away of habitat is actually one of the main reasons for endangered species. And additionally, there are government policies, on the other hand, that can be helpful. A great example is the Global Forest Watch in Indonesia, and Indonesia holds the second largest forest. And there they calculated actually that deforestation has been at its lowest point since 2003, which is good news. And lastly, this is where Frida and I can reconvene, maybe bounce back and off with each other. These are some problems that we have noticed, and some of the solutions that you can do as well. Because how is there any point in teaching you everything and then not telling you also some of the things that you can do in your daily lives? So if Frida would like to begin with that.
Yeah, definitely. So as you could tell, one of the first things that you see on the upper left corner is people doing a beach cleaning. So being able to, well, the problem would be people littering in beaches, and that would cause, as you can see, different marine ecosystems like that turtle, you know, swallowing and getting the plastic bags caught in their throat or caught in their body. And like we mentioned before, that sea turtle is a keystone species, and it doesn't just affect them, it affects all sorts of species. So being able to, one, be mindful and not littering in the beaches or other important habitats, and two, definitely if you see litter, pick it up with your community. You can go together and make an event out of it, you know, make an event of bonding and doing beach cleanups. And another aquatic problem that you see below is acidification, where it's caused by the change of the pH in the water. And with this is effect of the rising CO2 emissions, and just being mindful of your carbon footprint and realizing that all the actions that you have consequences. And as you already learned, how important coral reefs are. So keeping that in mind by being more careful and trying to reduce the amount of time you use your car, maybe doing more public transportation or conserving water, turning off the lights, all of that will indirectly help reduce an overall CO2 emissions. And another note is the type of sunblock that you use could also affect the coral reefs, because if you use more chemical-based sunscreens, they are more likely to harm the coral reef. So opting for more zinc oxide mineral-based sunscreens is a better alternative. And Bianca could pass it off a bit.
Yeah, of course. So a few years ago, I found out that landfills are composed of 70% food waste, which I believe is a big problem. If you can't finish the food on your plate, then maybe there's a way to reuse that, right? And you can do that through composting. There are different ways to compost at home. At our high school, we're able to compost on a larger scale because there are a lot more students, but it has actually taught me the importance of not wasting the food that we eat. Additionally, of course, there is the classic planting, keeping up the biodiversity if you have a backyard, or even if you can have a little pot with your own type of greenery. Of course, we've addressed the issue of deforestation, as resources are not infinite, especially those kinds of resources. They're non-renewable. So additionally, they take away the habitat of many animals that we've learned are essential. As you can see, there are the ivory tusks of elephants, which goes into the hunting of these kinds of animals. We hope that there will soon be more strict regulations and policies that go against these kinds of things, because they deliberately take away the lives of these animals that we so need in our food systems and in our ecosystems as well. And I think that leads us into how important education is, because now we see how important these species are, how although we are the most dominant species on the planet, we're not the only species on the planet. And we need to understand how to care for those other species surrounding us. So not only educating yourself, but educating others. And that's what we do here at The Green Cause. Next slide, please.
Oh, I just wanted to add something.
Of course.
Yeah. So one thing to add, of course, you know, we have to focus on educating others, as education is an integral part to being able to create a larger change. As you can see on the top right picture of pollution, this is all obviously caused by a lot of the fossil fuels that we see, but not only does it affect us as entirety, but it disproportionately affects certain communities more than others. And those people technically will usually get the short end of the stick by having to breathe in the polluted air, having to drink contaminated water, and not having their voices heard when they're addressing concerns. So obviously, taking more time to not only educate yourself on environmental injustices, but also contributing to better helping so there is more environmental justice. And that is by not only listening to them, but also politically you can, as you know, some people here are also fellow high schoolers and they feel like maybe their voices won't be heard. But if calling, you know, a local representative or putting petitions or protests to kind of make sure that everyone's voice can be heard equally, and not only having us help them, but we don't obviously want to speak over those communities, but we want to form relationships where we can mutually help each other, because this is our world, everyone's world. We all essentially, you know, rely on the same resources and we all have to come together. And back to a bit of what Bianca mentioned with the Green Cause, because as the Green Cause, we also do want to contribute to that as well.
Yeah, so the role that education plays in climate change is huge. You know, before middle school, I didn't know a lot about the sustainability factors of my daily life. And when all these things were revealed to me, I learned the why factors. You know, I learned that I didn't just have to turn off the lights or turn off the faucet because the bills would be much higher. Of course, that's a reason, but a reason for a little girl, it didn't really make as much sense as, the clean water. We don't have as much clean water as we think we do, right? Although the 70% of the planet is water, only 2% of that is fresh water, which is water we can drink. And half of that 2% is stuck in glaciers, which we don't want to melt. And if they do melt, we'll just become marine water anyway. Students that we provide an outlet for here at the Green Cause, specifically high school members, those students not necessarily have a background in sustainability, but have that passion to want to do something about it. So many times we see people or young youth post something, maybe on their Instagram story, reposting a polar bear without a habitat, or maybe I've seen recently masks around the feet of birds, and they repost, but they don't know what else to do. Well, here at the Green Cause, we tell them that they can not only learn something in their research to build a lesson plan, such as what we've just showed you, but they can then share it with others that may not have known what they just found out. Institutions, additionally, can raise a more awareness in the quality of what they are producing and attend to a population that can consume those sustainable products. Communities in themselves, as Frida mentioned, can be more involved in their political choices, and voting, of course, is extremely important. And I think Frida can take it over with what specifically we do here at the Green Cause step by step.
Yeah, of course. So like Bianca mentioned, we produce a lot of educational content that is not only lesson plans that we'd plan on sending to different elementary and middle schools, but also different sort of videos and posts that we would post on our Instagram. So just to break it down a bit more, we have three teams. So the first team would be environmental educators, and they would be the ones who are the ones to make the lessons and do that research and either film a video of them creating a lesson presentation, kind of like ours, that's very interactive and is solution-based, and no matter what age their audience is, because we need to empower our future generations so they feel like they can do something and they become the next sustainable leaders. And then we have the social media people, and they're the people who are making those infographics, those shorter but more visually oriented slides that are also a condensed version of research that they have conducted, and PSA videos, which are also more captivating, kind of focusing more on like the video quality production, but they can do anything with that. It's usually 2 to 3 minutes. They can make a skit, they can make just a beautifully produced video with a bunch of pictures, or they can even talk themselves. There are so many choices, and we want them to feel as if their voices are really heard and that they can have total creativity. And then the last team that we have is the technology team, and they focus a bit more on behind the scenes, and they help us with video editing and anything that wouldn't be completely in the limelight, but we do need them, and they're just as important because they kind of help our whole organization stay grounded. And in the link in the chat, I posted some links of our website and our Instagram. So on our website, you can learn a bit more about who we are. And if there are any high school audience members here, you can definitely feel free to join. And we are definitely looking to collaborate with anybody who's interested. Thank you.
Thank you, Frida and Bianca. Thank you so much for this fantastic workshop. You know, I didn't fully know what to expect when you first shared Life Around the World about the biodiversity session, but you know, we hear a lot and see a lot the talk about how biodiversity is so important to sustain life and to sustain the system, but to really have you explain to us what each species and their value, their uniqueness, it really adds to the appreciation of just the whole system and each species. And you didn't leave the discussion just at that. You were also talking about the actions we can take individually and the regulations we can push for in our systems as well, both individual and collective. And that's so valuable to hear. So thank you so much for this fantastic workshop. I know you wanted to do a little bit of a, were there some last links you wanted to share? The Kahoot, should I pull that up for you?
Firstly, yeah, thank you for the very nice remarks. But yeah, I'm not entirely sure how much time we have left, but we did originally plan to make a Kahoot to kind of show like a review of everything, but I'm not sure we have enough time for that, unfortunately. But I did post some links. I don't know if you would want to post them again, but they were of our website, of our Instagram. And in our website, for those who are interested in joining, can fill out an interest form. And those who are interested in partnering with us, those who are faculty members, teachers from different schools, who would love to see presentations like this done by students, student voices in their classrooms, then you can definitely see our email in the website as well.
Thank you so much. And we'll make sure to post all the links you shared in our forum that is going to be ongoing and live for the whole week. So that, and for everyone who's on, that's also where you can write some remaining questions for Frida and Bianca as well. So that wraps up our first day of the summit. We hope you enjoyed kind of the curation we did for this first day in terms of bringing different leaders, but also practitioners. And as you can see, Frida and Bianca, who are really youth leaders and passionate about taking action and really making it happen in their communities and beyond. So thank you so much to everyone who joined us today. We hope you will also stick by I for the rest of the week. We have a lot of things lined up for you all. Tomorrow specifically is going to be on community organizing through storytelling. And I'm sure Frida and Bianca could relate to this as well. Just being able to take not just your passion, but really having it broken down into steps, getting your community involved. That's so critical for getting things done. So tomorrow's conversation is going to center around community organizing workshop. And then we also have a panel of practitioners who are in New Jersey who are really at the table when curriculum is getting decided for the state. So very interesting conversations upcoming. So we hope you'll join us. Please feel free to, we'll send the join in link for tomorrow through the Eventbrite. So please stay connected with us. And thank you everyone so much. We'll see you again tomorrow. And thank you so much, Brita and Bianca, again for your workshop.
Thank you for the opportunity and thank you for everyone who came to listen.
Thank you so much. Thanks everyone.